And welcome back. Today we are transforming your health with Columbia St. Mary's. Today, what you need to know about dementia and why it's important to recognize the signs and get a diagnosis as early as possible.
That's right. As we age, most of us will experience problems with our memories, but disorders such as dementia and Alzheimer's are not a normal part of the aging process. Dr. Peter Leo is a neuropsychologist with Columbia St. Mary's, and he's here with more on the difference between typical aging issues and the signs of a more serious problem. Good to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, I think this is what people worry about. You know, if we become more forgetful, we can't remember where our keys are, or we just don't remember certain things, we're like, uh-oh, am I having an issue?
Sure.
So how do you differentiate?
Yeah, you know, having more difficulty with memory, having more difficulty finding the right word to use, forgetting the names for things, that's a part of normal aging. I think that what you have to be concerned about is when it starts interfering with your day-to-day functioning.
Excuse me.
Mm-hmm. When it starts interfering with your day-to-day functioning and kind of really getting in the way of you doing things is when you should start to kind of be more concerned about it.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people will wonder what the difference is between what you described as a normal aging process and the sign of a disorder or disease.
Yeah, you know, it's interference. So when you start having more difficulties with balancing your checkbook or you're forgetting bills, overdue bills, things like that, getting more confused using appliances you should know
like
how to
microwave
use. Like
or
a microwave,
remote.
Exactly.
Okay.
Remotes nowadays are so complicated that
I
use that a little bit less. But, but yeah, definitely a microwave or something you've used for a long time that was something you could do well in the past that's maybe a little more challenging. And again, gets in the way of you functioning day to day.
Okay. So even if in thinking about dates or things like that, it's not like I don't know that it's Tuesday, it's more that I don't know what the season is or the time of year.
Would that be a bigger
kind of issue?
Yeah, and it could be dates, so kind of disorientation to dates could be part of it, but if it doesn't come back to you quickly and you can't orient yourself pretty quickly as far as figuring out what day it is and what you have going on, then that's probably more of an issue.
Okay. I'm fascinated to know in your experience who it is who tends to notice the problem. Mm-hmm. Is it often a spouse or significant other? Is it adult children? Or is it the person themselves?
Yeah, you know, it varies actually. It can be a lot of different people. Definitely children, adult children are somebody who's a little concerned about mom or dad, especially they don't see them on a day-to-day basis, so especially if they haven't seen them for a month or two and then they come back and they feel like things are a little bit off. That's definitely a way that we get referrals. But people as well, you know, noticing that things are more difficult and they're not quite as sharp as they used to be.
Mm-hmm. Is it genetic? Is it something that if you know you know someone in your family had issues that you should be concerned for yourself or family?
Yeah, there's a genetic component to it, like most things, but you know what we know is it's relatively smaller than I think people think. If you do have a relative who has you know Alzheimer's, your chances are a little bit higher than other folks. But you know, really, the genetics make up about 20 to 25% of the risk factor, and the other risk factors are modifiable things, so things that we can work on and improve. And so that's kind of the focus of what we talk to patients about.
Mm-hmm. What do you suggest someone should do if they're concerned about a loved one who has memory or seems to have memory issues?
Yeah, I think the first place is to start with your general practitioner, so your primary care physician, and start that discussion with them. There's a number of things that can cause memory problems that might be a little bit in excess of normal aging, such as medications. So medication side effects, things of that nature, that your primary care can look over and figure out. Also, you know, there's some you know vitamin deficiencies, things like that, that can contribute to hypothyroid, can contribute to some early memory difficulties, and those are what we call reversible, reversible memory problems. And so start with your primary care physician and see kind of the initial assessment to see if there's something that can be ruled out that could be causing it.
So if at that point your primary says, hey, I think you need to see a neuropsychologist, if you go in, what kind of evaluations do you do and what's sort of covered or maybe uncovered by insurance?
Yeah, typically our evaluations are covered by insurance, especially for Medicare. That's not usually an issue. We do a pre-authorization before you come in to make sure that everything's going to be taken care of. But it's a pretty comprehensive evaluation. So typically I'll spend about 45 minutes to an hour talking to the patient, and typically a family member too. So we like it when you know, a spouse comes in or a child. You know, sometimes, especially with dementia, people don't have a good insight into the issues they're having. So it's helpful to have somebody else there in the appointment initially. Then we'll excuse the family member, and then we do one-on-one testing with the patient, looking at memory and attention and problem solving and language and kind of all the different thinking skills your brain does.
Is it possible for someone to sort of, and I don't know if it's the right word, hide their dementia or their memory problems?
You know, people can compensate. compensate pretty well sometimes, especially
writing things down.
Using notes, and those are things, again, as you get older, you're going to rely more on regardless.
Yeah.
If you have Alzheimer's disease, people who have routines too typically can do well. So if you have the same routine, older folks who aren't on a lot of medications or don't have a lot of changes to their health, they've lived in the same home for the last 60 years. Mm-hmm. Their routine's kind of set, and there's not a lot of new learning, so they can compensate pretty well, pretty well with it, especially early on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Lastly, too, just is there a way to stop it? Is there anything you can do when you're working with a professional?
Yeah, there's medications that can be helpful to sort of delay the progress of it or help your memory somewhat. And that's why, early identification is important to kind of, if those medications are appropriate, the earlier the better as far as getting on them. But I think that the most important things are just behavioral things that we can do day to day. Exercise, eating a healthy diet, keeping yourself, engaged, cognitively engaged. So with
sleep,
thinking.
Do those word problems too.
Puzzles, things like that. Keeping your mind sharp, being socially engaged. So, getting out and doing things socially is very good for your brain as well.
I think the key too, as you said, is that evaluation and diagnosis early. So to contact Columbia St. Mary's, here's how you do that. You can schedule an appointment with Dr. Leo by calling 414-332-DOCS, which is 3627. There's the website as well for more. Thanks for being here, doctor.
Thank you so much.
Great to meet you.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.